Hello and welcome to our webinar. We're really pleased to see that a record number of people have registered for this webinar today, so we hope that everyone is able to join us. Welcome to today's webinar focusing on monitoring emissions from forest degradation. This is the fifth in the Red Plus Monitoring and Measuring, Reporting and Verification Training the Trainers webinar series, sponsored by the World Bank Forest Carbon Partnership Facility with support from other partners. My name is Sarah Carter, and I'm from GOFC-GOLD in Wageningen University, two of the organizing partners. For more information on the webinar series and for web links to the materials relevant for today's webinar, you can visit the GOFC-GOLD webpage, which is listed on this slide. And you can also contact me using the email address, which you also see on the slide. It should just be showing now. By the end of the week, you can also find the recording of this webinar also available on our website. It's the same link there. This webinar will last for around 1.5 hours. So first, I'm going to give a quick introduction to the webinar series, and then we'll have presentations by Dr. Tim Pearson and Lara Murray from WinRock International on today's topic. So following the presentations, we're going to have a 2-minute break where you can post your questions in the question box in the webinar control panel. And after that, our presenters will answer your questions. But you can also post questions at any time in the chat box in your webinar control panel. So please do so. So first, to put today's webinar in the context of the bigger picture of Red Plus MRV and also the webinar series. This slide shows some tools and methodologies which can help you to negotiate the Red Plus MRV process. And the orange numbers show which webinars are covering which topics. So you can see now that we're on webinar number 5 on focusing on degradation. So after today's webinar, we have 2 remaining webinars. The first one after today will be a focus on the best practices for accuracy assessments with Boston University and FAO. And the last webinar in the series will demonstrate CEPAL, which is a cloud computing platform which can be used to manage and analyze data. We included tools in this slide which will be presented in the series, but of course there are other tools available which you might find useful. So going back a bit, we started the webinar series with a webinar on the Red Compass. So if you missed this webinar, we would recommend that you go to our website and watch the video. The Red Compass is the base of our webinar series, and this tool refers to all the other tools and methodologies on the slide, indicating when and for what purpose you can use them. So focusing in on the Red Compass, this is one of the main activities which we're going to cover today. And you can also see which of the GOFC-GOLD training modules are relevant as well on this slide. So please do check these out again on our website. And you can also watch video lectures on these GOFC-GOLD training modules. So we'd really recommend that if you're interested in this topic of emissions from forest degradation, you would watch those videos. And those videos have also been developed in collaboration with WinRock International. So I'm delighted to introduce our 2 speakers today, Dr. Timothy Pearson from WinRock International, and also Lara Murray, also from WinRock International. Tim's going to begin, so please, Tim, the floor is yours.
Hi, my name's Tim Pearson. I'm very happy to talk to you all today. I am the Director of Ecosystem Services here at WinRock. For those of you who don't know, WinRock International is a non-profit organization that works with people around the world to empower the disadvantaged, increase economic opportunity, and sustain natural resources. Our particular group, Ecosystem Services within WinRock, functions to translate science, to operate between academic systems and policymakers and for-profit organizations, commodity producers, to try and understand how accounting can happen for ecosystem services, for greenhouse gases, for water, for other factors in a way that's cost-effective and meaningful, to try and bring in economic considerations and facilitate market-based approaches. So we've been working for over 20 years now in greenhouse gases associated with forests and agriculture, and over the last 15 years we've been looking directly at how we can do a job of accounting forest degradation emissions in a way that's going to be meaningful but is not going to be excessively costly. So today we're going to try and sweep through this topic, and then we'll be there at the end to answer any specific questions you have, if there's things that you would like us to have gone into more depth on, or issues that you would like to know more about. There are also many resources we've produced through time that we're certainly very happy to share that give more detail on the approaches. But I'm briefly going to cover what is forest degradation, how we'd go about integrating degradation, how we will estimate emissions or can estimate emissions from forest degradation, and then finally some considerations for including forest degradation into national forest monitoring systems. So first of all, forest degradation. I think we're all much more aware of deforestation. It's the much simpler case where you have an area of forest, that forest is removed, and you're left with an alternative land use, whether that be agriculture or urban or industrial. And the change is clear, and the approach for accounting emissions is usually clear as well. You take the area of forest that's lost and apply a factor that represents the carbon stock of the area that's lost. Often, through losing the tree cover, you're also going to expose that soil, and you're going to lose a number of emissions from the soil as well under the new land use. Forest degradation is somewhat different. The forest remains forest in the case of forest degradation. You're going from an area from with a higher carbon stock forest to an area with a low-end carbon stock forest, but it stays as forest. And some common examples are logging of that forest, selective logging, where a few high-value trees are cut down and taken out of the forest, but the forest remains. Or fuel wood collection, where fuels are taken out of the forest for cooking or heating or industry, but forest remains. Or forest fires, where through the management of land, fires escape, or fires are purposefully set that remove some of the trees but do not cause a deforestation event. So, as I said, forest degradation reflects changes in forests that remain forests, and they lead to a persistent decline in that carbon stock. The UNFCCC calls it a human-induced long-term loss of carbon stocks in forests, remaining forests, but they leave those values. You know, does that stock persist, the decreased stock persists for some amount of years, and there is a some amount percentage decrease in the carbon stocks. If we look through different systems, the UNFCCC encourages complete accounting, but they want that to be in accordance with the existing capabilities and national circumstances within those countries. But they make the specific statement that significant activity should not be excluded. So there needs to be some understanding of how important those degradation activities are before they be written off and not included at all. The VCFS is more specific, that wants complete accounting. But does not say, but activities included need not be comprehensive. And so individual activities can be selected. You can choose to include timber harvesting, but exclude fuel wood collection if that is an insignificant emission source within the country. The FCPF of the World Bank is yet more specific. It sets this criteria. If degradation emissions are more than 10% of total forest-related emissions, then they should be included. But all of these approaches require you to have some estimation of what the emissions are in order to say whether they're significant or not. So some degree of accounting has to happen in order to determine the significance and determine whether additional resources are invested going forward. So if we think about the logical viewpoint from someone investing in an activity, a country or a subnational area, trying to determine what degradation activities should be included and how. The key thought should be, is this a significant emission source? And this is usually known, and then there are tools that are out there that can help get that first viewpoint. And you heard about one of them if you attended the second webinar on the World Bank's DST decision support tool, which Winrock was the developer of. That allows you to define country or an area within a country and get a first estimation of those emissions. And you can clearly see this is a significant emission source or it likely is not. If an emission source is significant, clearly it indicates it probably should be included. Second consideration should be, is there capacity and are there resources to reliably measure and monitor these emissions cost effectively? The complexity, as we're going to talk about later on, of degradation accounting means that it can be costly, and investing a large amount of money and coming up with a small number is rarely going to make sense. And the third consideration is one that people will often overlook. Is there a potential that interventions can be put in that will reduce those degradation emissions? There are going to be cases where degradation emissions exist and may be somewhat significant, but there's either no appetite or no potential to reduce those emissions. You know, an example could be if timber harvesting is an extremely significant sector within a country and the practices already are reduced impact to a large extent, then there may be little potential to further reduce those emissions, even though they exist, they're an important economic part for the part of the country. So again, what are those sources of forest degradation? A key one is clearly timber harvesting, and you can see those from the first two pictures. Those are from the Republic of Congo, a log that's been cut down. These are often very large trees. They can be a meter or 2 meters in diameter, these trees, and the felling of the trees felled during the process of felling the trees. It causes damage to the surrounding canopy. Then a bulldozer or a skidder will pull that log out of the forest to a road that has to be constructed. That's the top right picture that takes those logs onto a mill for further processing. So logging is a key source of forest degradation. Secondly, fuel wood collection. Through most of the tropics, fuel wood is an important source of energy, and that fuel typically comes from, you know, forests as well as from agricultural land and surrounding homes. And there's some balance there between the supply and the demand and whether the fuel wood is sustainable and causes forest degradation. Another key one in many countries is fire. Fire is an important management method in many lands. If those fires escape into the forest or are used in a less than optimal way, then you're going to cause a degradation of that forest. Other sources can be overgrazing, particularly in forest areas, surrounding fields, then the entry of livestock into the forest, it'll damage the regeneration of that forest, and over a long time period will likely cause a degradation of those stocks. Many would call shifting cultivation also a form of degradation, but we think this in most cases is not the case. Shifting cultivation is initially a deforestation event as the area goes from forest to an agricultural land use, which includes that fallow cycle. If the fallow cycle is shortened in our viewpoint, then that can be a forest degradation. There are other sources of degradation that have typically been shown to be very minor. This can be, for example, around mining sites, some of the tailings of the mining causing losses in forest stocks. But the analysis we've shown has shown that logging, fuel wood collection, and fire are the dominant forces of forest degradation in the tropics. And so the work we did for the World Bank's Decision Support Tool fed into this analysis that we published just 3 months ago, looking at total emissions from forest degradation across the tropics. And we're able to show that about a quarter of the combined emissions of forest deforestation and forest degradation are forest degradation. So this is a highly significant emission source. One in four emissions is from degradation. And if we break that out by type, then 53% was from selective timber harvest, 30% from fuel wood harvest, and 17% from forest fire. And these can be viewed somewhat as an underestimate in that we had not included illegal timber harvest, illegal logging in those estimations. For many countries, illegal logging is highly significant as an emission source. So this was across 74 pan-tropical countries, as I said. So the number there was 2.1 billion tons of carbon dioxide per year, which in isolation probably doesn't mean very much, but we can start to compare that against other sources of emissions. Waste management globally, the landfilling of products, is responsible for 1.47 billion tons of carbon dioxide, so less. We look at global shipping or international aviation. Both of those are areas of policy focus right now for mitigating those greenhouse gas emissions. Both of those significantly less than the emissions from forest degradation. If we look at it at a country level, that 2.1 billion tons per year is more than any country except China, the US, and India. And we can look at that across the countries examined, and you can see that clearly there are high points for emissions in some of the large forest countries. We're looking at Brazil and the Congo Basin and across Indonesia. This clearly reflects a lot of timber harvesting in some of these countries. In the south of Congo there, you can see a prevalence of fire. If we look at South Asia, India, Pakistan, and East Africa, Ethiopia there, for example, those are places where we're seeing high amounts of fuel wood emissions from forest degradation. And we can look at this another way through these bubbles, where these are all in scale. So the size of the bubble reflects the number of emissions. And you can see the circle here represents 50 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. So you can show, again, Brazil has high emissions. It's a large country with a lot of forest, high emissions in Indonesia, India, many countries. And we break that up, and you can show the selective logging being a high source of emissions from Brazil and Indonesia, also Malaysia and Philippines. Fire being fairly significant in some of those African countries, DRC and Angola, and then the wood fuel emissions being significant there in South Asia and in North and East Africa. And then under support from IUCN, we took this globally, so you can start to see even beyond the tropics where there are emissions from forest degradation. These are often fire emissions in across Russia and across parts of Canada, for example, parts of Australia, but also emissions from timber harvest, where the timber harvest is selected. So if we want to integrate forest degradation into MRV systems, those questions we have to ask is the degradation a significant source of emissions? What specific types of degradation occurring, and how important are those specific types? Because that lets us really target our resources on the significant sources and where we can have an impact. What systems for measuring and monitoring are appropriate? Where is their capacity in the country, and where are their abilities and interest? And what might be no regrets options for accounting for cases where significant investment is either not possible or not of interest? So, as I've said, the methods and efforts should really depend on the significance of the emissions from degradation activity. If you have an activity, for example, fuel wood harvest in a particular country, and it only represents a fraction of a percent of the total emissions, then putting large resources into coming up with a good number of those emissions is not going to be a worthy pursuit. Instead, really needs to be a balancing of the costs against the effort and the put in. And so we look at the magnitude of the activity, the magnitude of the opportunity to reduce emissions from the activity against the precision of those methods to estimate impact. And this is one of my favorite pictures actually on the wall in my office in front of me right now, because I think it really does tell this story very well. This is the Congo Basin, it's Cameroon here. Right up here is the Central African Republic, and then we're seeing the Republic of Congo here, and this is work under the CARPE program for USAID. But the key thing I want you to look at is down here in this corner around Weso, you can see deforestation quite clearly. This is an area that was previously forested. It's being cleared for these towns and agriculture around. This area here is an incredibly important area for timber harvest, and yet your ability to see that in this image is very limited. If you look very closely, you probably can see some roads, but you're not seeing large numbers of gaps where massive trees are being taken out of the forest. And this is the key problem, really, for degradation against deforestation. Deforestation, a moderate resolution satellite image is going to pick up that deforestation. We're going to be able to say, this is the area that's being cleared. We're going to be able to have emission factors that represent the carbon stock of the area cleared. We put the two together and it comes up with an emission. For forest degradation, in moderate resolution imagery, the best hope really is that we're going to come up with an area of roads, and then we're going to need fairly significant effort to try and create correlating factors between area of roads and amount of degradation emissions. It's going to require a significant amount of field work probably in each country. An alternative could be high resolution imagery, much more costly, of course. But if you apply high resolution imagery, you probably are going to see those gaps and probably skid trails coming through the forest in the case of logging. And so you're going to be able to have an area of both of those. But the issue is that within a month, and not much more than that, you're going to start to see a rapid closing of the canopy in some of these degradation situations. You're going to see the trees, surrounding trees, grow over skid trails and start to grow over gaps. And so even if you're doing an accurate job of capturing the existence of these gaps and trails and roads, you'd also need to know somehow how much time has passed since that degradation activity existed. Your emission factor is only going to be accurate to a specific point in time, and so highly faulty, because unless you specifically know every logging instance and the timing of it, then it's going to be very hard to use that high resolution approach. A better approach, a more accurate approach, is going to be to use LIDAR or radar, where you're going to be able to see through the canopy and you start to be able to see some of the tunnels, for example, for skid trails going through the forest, and you're going to be able to see under the canopy to get the full area of the gap. But again, you're going to need an awful lot of field work to try and create these factors that let you get an emission from the area of these impacts on canopy. And clearly these remote sensing approaches are highly costly in and of themselves. So, estimating emissions from forest degradation. It is difficult to detect using available remote sensing imagery. The free imagery, for example, Landsat, that we use typically for deforestation accounting just doesn't do a good job at this point. I think we all have the belief and confidence that as we move into the future, we're going to see the onward progression of technology and the onward progression of remote sensing approaches, and there is going to be a simple remote sensing solution to that, right, to this situation, but it doesn't exist right now, and it pushes us to do more work on the ground level, to take alternate approaches to try and come up with how we're going to estimate emissions from forest degradation. So even within that, we have to think that impacts of degradation activities on forest cover differ by the type of degradation. It's going to be very different if you're having timber harvest, where we talked about roads being put in and skid trails and gaps being formed, from something like fuel wood harvest, which could be just taking out a few favored species for fuel wood for particular villages, or a grading of lower diameter trees that can be easily cut and taken out of the forest. That's going to be very different from timber harvest, and that again is going to be very different to a fire which has come through, killed a proportion of the trees, damaged a proportion of the trees, but left a proportion of the trees. Where non-remote sensing methods are used, these often will rely on data to get you that activity data. The activity data, which in remote sensing imagery would be the area of the impact. If it's on a ground-based method, it's often going to be the statistics on the amount of fuel wood that's used or the amount of logs that are taken out of the forest, and those can be limited be lacking. And a final problem is that regrowth is often not accounted for. Regrowth obviously doesn't always occur after forest degradation. Forest degradation reflects the access of people to forests, people using that forest, and once forests start to lose stocks, often they will continue on that trajectory or stay at that lower carbon stock level. But there are cases where regrowth would happen. For example, if a fire penetrated far into the forest and caused damage, then we would expect regrowth to happen. And it's tricky for methodologies to capture those emissions. We typically would just look at the gross emissions, the emissions that happened at this point in time, as opposed to the emissions that happen over the next, or the removals that happen afterwards over the next 20 or 30 years. So I think it's worth stepping back very quickly to tackle the issue of land-based accounting approaches versus activity-based accounting approaches. We typically focus on activity-based accounting approaches because they're cost-effective and they're accurate. But land-based approaches do exist and are being used by some countries and do definitely have things in their favor. So a land-based approach, for those who are less familiar, we'll look at a total area. In this case, we'll look at this whole red box. And within that total red box, they'll look at what is the total carbon stock at time one and the total carbon stock at time two. So the stock that's existing in all of those trees that are on that image, and the soil, and so at time one, this could be totally forested. At time two, some of these trees have been cut, and this area here has been deforested. And so the total stock at time one and time two are going to be different, and the difference is the emission that results from both deforestation and degradation under the land-based approach. On an activity-based approach, we look specifically at the activities. So you're going to focus on this area here of deforestation. You're going to record the area under which canopy has been lost, and you're going to apply the emission factor, which represents the carbon stock of the forest before that area was cleared. We're separately going to look at this logging. We're going to look on our ground-based approach at what is the volume that's being extracted, and then what is the emission factor? How many emissions happen per cubic meter, for example, is extracted from the forest? So here are some examples. There's land-based approaches, for example, in Vietnam or Chile. And those pros are that it's a transparent, verifiable, measurable approach. It offers a complete accounting so that if unpredicted emissions happened in a distant part of the forest, then that would just be captured as a matter of course under a land-based approach. Well, under an activity-based approach, it's likely it would be overlooked. Downsides are it does require a large amount of data, it's often highly expensive, and the scale that results because of the expense is often coarse, meaning that small-scale impacts are usually overlooked. Equally, it just gives usually this final number, and so it's difficult to distinguish between different activities, which provides a complexity when you're trying to plan how to mitigate emissions, how to implement activities that are going to reduce emissions from deforestation and degradation. It helps if you know specifically what's happening in what place, and the land-based approach does not necessarily allow that. The activity-based approach examples are Guyana and Ghana, for example. They're often more cost-effective. It again is a transparent measurement approach. It usually is going to be much better at picking up small-scale impacts. It lasers down really on what the emissions look like, where they're happening, and what the associated greenhouse gas emissions are. If you take this approach, if you're not specifically targeting an activity, for example, you include logging but you don't include fuel wood, then any emissions from fuel wood are going to not be included. And it also faces that challenge of accurately capturing regrowth that will happen. So I want to talk a little bit about the source of degradation emissions that we've spent the most time on, and it's the source of emissions that is most important through our analysis. 53% of degradation emissions, were a quarter of emissions, so this is somewhere close to 15% of total emissions comes from timber harvesting in the tropics. And it's important to understand a little bit of the progression of what's happening when timber's harvesting. If we look at this simplified figure, you have an area of forest, and right here in the middle is clearly a high-value timber species. Logging process is planned, and this tree is cut. Through the process of the tree being cut, it falls. It, in many cases, will hit smaller trees on the way down, snapping, uprooting those trees. The log is then cut, leaving the stump and the top of the tree remaining in the forest, as well as any of these trees incidentally created, turned into dead wood. These remain in the forest and are either decomposed, going up into the atmosphere, or maybe burned and go up into the atmosphere. The logs are then skidded out of the forest using bulldozers or skidders into logging decks, subsequently put into trucks, taken on the road to mills. In those mills have some degree of conversion efficiency. So a proportion of the logs is converted into products, which are then used, ultimately abandoned or burned, and go up into the atmosphere or into landfill. And a proportion becomes sawdust, which is then burned or subsequently emitted. So the base of our approach was published a couple of years ago in a previous paper. It's also covered in GOFC-GOLD module 2.3. It takes an IPCC gain loss approach using typically national data, could be local data, could even be concession-specific data on harvest volumes, and then field measurements to come up with those emission factors. It includes all the relevant emission sources I was talking about, the log that's extracted from the forest, the incidental damage, the top and that stump that remain in the forest, and any emissions that happen from the logging infrastructure, building the roads, the skid trails, and the logging decks. So as I said, the activity data is typically the timber harvest volumes. These can be from national statistics or reporting from timber concessions or mills, or you can create approaches through remote sensing to assess an area of log forest and infrastructure. So if you have a good remote sensing system, we're working on a project in Indonesia right now using LIDAR, where we're able to try and create these relationships between easily measured factors, for example, the area of roads and then the total emissions that happen, allow us to create these correlations that can produce ultimately a cost-effective measurement approach. So your activity data is usually going to be your cubic meters that come from some form of statistics. And then your emission factor is your estimate of emissions from the extracted timber, from the damage, from the infrastructure. And that emission factor is tons of carbon dioxide per cubic meter extracted from the forest, as opposed to deforestation, where the emission factor is usually tons of carbon dioxide per hectare. Simple values, if this is going to be a lower significance emission source, can come from our paper. If it's a more significant emission source or higher priority for the country, then it's clearly advised and important that original field data be collected in that country and country-specific emission factors created for the, you know, the harvesting practices and the potential changes in harvesting practices with associated emissions and sequestration. So we divide that emission from logging into three different parts, which I've mentioned but have not given names to. So we have the extracted log emissions. That's the log that's taken out of the forest. It captures the emissions from that log when it goes to the mill. The 50% or approximately 50% that's lost immediately in the conversion efficiency from that log to products, and then the subsequent retirement and emission of the products that are in use. And we usually would look at what proportion of that log is effectively permanently sequestered, taking the assumption that based on this, the residence time of CO2 in the atmosphere, that any product that is still sequestered after 100 years, either still in use or sequestered in a landfill system, would be permanently sequestered, and anything else would represent an emission. So the first step would be to estimate the volume of the log being cut in a specific gap, and wood density would allow you to calculate what's the biomass and the carbon dioxide equivalent of that log, and then you need specific data from mills and specific data on use of products within countries to work out what the emissions are going to be from that log, from the cubic meters of that log extracted from the forest. The second factor is the logging damage factor. You can see some logging gaps can be quite a mess, and that's the top of the tree, the branches, and the leaves, all of the top of that tree, the non-commercial part that's left in the forest, the stump can have significant volume and biomass itself. And then, depending on the quality of the logging practices, it's invariably small trees will be hit and knocked down during the process of timber harvesting, and in the poorer logging practices, then the damage can be done to other large trees as well with fairly significant emissions. In our paper, we created some of these correlation factors, which are fairly strong actually, to try and estimate this logging damage factor. So a simplified approach would be to say, based on the biomass carbon stock of the forest, we can estimate what the logging damage factor would be. And here you can see a fairly strong relationship, or an even stronger relationship is if you know the mean log length of logs being taken out of the forest, here's the estimated logging damage factor. And these strong relationships really are the result of the fact that the big majority of the logging damage factor is the stump and the top of that tree. And so it's correlatable from the size of the log, and the size of the log is correlatable with the amount of carbon in the forest. So you can create these relationships to get some idea of what a logging damage factor would be. Clearly, these represent, you know, standard practices. So if very poor practices were in place before the project start, then, you know, clearly there could be higher emissions from these logging damage factors. And if very good practices were implemented, then there could be a lower factor that were compared against that. So for maintaining the same volume extracted from the forest, there could be an emission reduction. But that would require specific field work to determine that. Somewhat more complex can be the infrastructure. As we say, the trees are felled in gaps, and those logs are then extracted from the forest down some of these skid trails before getting to these road areas. And using a bulldozer or a skidder to pull those logs through the forest causes some proportion of emissions. Logs are then typically stacked in decks beside the road, which represents an area from which trees are cleared and will therefore have an emission associated. And then the roads themselves can be a significant emission. Roads can often be fairly wide in order to maintain the drying of those roads in wet seasons, for example. And so the area of the road across a logging concession could be fairly significant, and therefore there can be a fairly significant emission. You clearly need to calculate this this logging infrastructure factor, and this requires a combination of field data usually and remote sensing imagery. So you can say, for this given area of this concession, here's the volume that's extracted, and here is the damage resulting from the infrastructure needed to extract that volume. And in the end, you'd come up with an emission from infrastructure per cubic meter extracted. I think I'm handing over to Lara now.
Fabulous, thank you. So again, I'm Lara Murray from Windrock International, and I will go ahead and go over the approaches for estimating degradation emissions from fuelwood collection and fire, and then I will wrap up the presentation. Fuelwood is supplied from a variety of sources. It can come as a byproduct of land use change, so where woody biomass is taken from fallow land during the shifting cultivation cycle. It can also be sourced from as a byproduct of logging activity, from deforestation. It can also come from woodlots, from standing or lying deadwood, or from cuttings from live trees. And when we're talking about forest degradation, we're interested in only the cuttings from live trees when they're extracted at a rate that exceeds the tree's ability to regenerate. So it's only this category that we're interested in, because that's what causes the persistent damage to forest biomass stocks over time. Okay. So clearly that makes accounting quite difficult, because we're only looking at a specific subset of where fuelwood is supplied from. But the WISDOM model, or the Wood Fuel Integrated Supply Demand Overview Mapping, developed by Bylis et al. In 2015, models fuelwood supply and then demand dynamics separately to determine the fraction of non-renewable biomass extracted. It combines the supply and demand modules to determine the fraction of non-renewable biomass. So in other words, it determines the proportion of the total fuelwood that is extracted that is considered non-sustainable. This modeling exercise isolates fuelwood sourced from non-land use change byproducts, so it avoids double counting. So it doesn't include, or it helps to isolate what wood is taken from deforestation and what wood is taken from cuttings from live trees. So this approach could be considered tier 2 or 3, because the modeling is conducted using available national or subnational data. In order to conduct the WISDOM analysis, as I mentioned, there's separate modules. The supply module uses data on biomass stocks, on biomass productivity, which is often just the mean annual increment of for biomass or trees within a given ecological system, and then where wood fuel is typically sourced from in the geographic area of interest, whether it's from woodlots, plantations, etc. On the demand modeling side, the population distribution and density is integrated. There's also household energy supply needs, spatial data on infrastructure, for roads, gas pipelines, and topography to see where the woodshed is, where population centers would be deriving their fuel wood from. Clearly, this wisdom approach does require a level of expertise in applying the model. So as a proxy until capacity is developed in applying the wisdom model or if another approach is taken, there are proxy data available that could suffice to provide countries with or national or subnational entities with an idea of what the level of emissions from fuel wood use are. As Tim mentioned, WinRock developed the World Bank RED Decision Support Toolbox, and on that website, there are data at the national and subnational levels for over 50 pantropical countries. Those data are only available for the year 2009, however, it represents a single data point, but it, as I said, can serve as intermediary data point for countries or subnational entities to understand what the whether or not fuel wood emissions could be considered significant. So for fire, where fire causes forest disturbance but not deforestation, that's where we are looking at where degradation emissions happen. In the case of fire as well, it's important to note that non-carbon dioxide greenhouse gases are generally significant, so nitrous oxide and methane. So it's important to include those within the accounting system for completeness, if at all possible. In the case of fire, remote sensing approach is generally acceptable. There are remote sensing products, so MODIS satellite burned area product offers monthly data on the area burned. As we can see here in this image of this map of Cambodia, it's using the MODIS data overlaid with the land cover map. So it's showing where fires are happening within forest areas between the years 2005 and 2010. So practitioners would just simply need to overlay land cover maps and clip to forest, non-forest to determine where fires have occurred and quantify the total area. Just as a note as well, the MODIS active fire product is also available, but this product captures only where fire hotspots exist, and so it's not really effectively able to capture where forest degradation activity has been happening. There's also the Global Fire Emissions Database. This was developed by Van der Werf in 2010. It's available online. It also offers global monthly data, but it actually quantifies dry matter emissions using the MODIS satellite burn area product. It includes an analysis for the tropical latitudes of both deforestation and non-deforestation fires, so forest degradation fires. And it can be useful when looking when doing large regional analyses, but it is at a much coarser resolution than the burn area products, so it's safe to say that it would be more appropriate for large regional analyses where sort of broader conclusions are being drawn rather than at the subnational level. There are some challenges worth noting when doing fire degradation accounting that should be mentioned as well. Often fires occur multiple times in the same pixel. Quite often happens when we have a lot of shifting cultivation activity, when we have a lot of fire happening around population centers. So where fire occurs multiple times in the same pixel, it's important to note that the emission factor that's being applied should account for the fact that the amount of combustible biomass diminishes over time. So when fire is happening over and over in the same area, it's less likely that the initial biomass stocks are going to be as high as they would have been during the first burning incident. The MODIS product also has very large pixel size, so that will make the capturing small degradation fires a lot harder. And then, as sort of a general note, of course, satellite imagery is probably less capable of capturing surface fires underneath a canopy. So it does, it is likely that it underestimates fire to some degree. So to wrap up the sort of final considerations for including forest degradation in national forest monitoring systems should be that countries really need to focus on what practical and realistic interventions can be introduced to reduce emissions, and then what possible methods are available that can appropriately capture those emissions reductions. Then countries will need to think about how they can balance that requirement against whatever the funding mechanisms they're trying to participate in. And then also methods really need to be replicable through time. There's always going to need to be a balance between consistency and stepwise improvements. So the methodologies applied to estimating emissions for the reference level should be consistent with those applied during the monitoring period. But of course, as capacity improves, as time goes on, stepwise improvements may be realistic to be introduced, and therefore, what's the balance between the consistency of approaches and improvements, and whether or not there's an appetite or necessity to rework any reference level to achieve the appropriate level of consistency. There's also data availability and in-country capacity. So what data sources were used to develop the reference level estimates, and whether those data sources are going to become consistently available for monitoring through time. Whether there are the resources committed both on a financial and political level to collecting all necessary data and training personnel. And also, illegal logging is often going to be significant, as Tim discussed as well, but of course very tough to monitor by its very nature. Illegal logging is likely to be a very good opportunity for emissions reductions, but it may be very hard to realize in practicality. So in conclusion, degradation is almost always significant, and so really has to be considered to some degree in when developing national monitoring systems under RED. Here we've offered a set of no regrets, credible methodologies that would be available for all significant emission sources, at least for estimating their level of significance, and then as a starting point. Also, of course, as Tim mentioned, there is an expectation and need for improved remote sensing methods for degradation, especially given the dispersed nature of degradation activities, but the scale and the potential cost of field-based methods that have higher precision. And finally, again, illegal logging is likely to be a highly underestimated source of emissions, and so that is probably an area where great inroads can be made. So that concludes the presentation. I guess at this point we will have a 2-minute break, but I'll let Sarah introduce that. Thank you very much.
Lara and Tim, thanks very much, both of you, for making a very, very interesting and comprehensive presentation looking at forest degradation. We've already had quite a lot of questions, which people have been posting, but we're just going to take a really quick 2-minute break in which you can continue to post your questions if you have more questions, and then after the 2-minute break we're going to try and answer as many of your questions as possible. So see you all in 2 minutes. Hello everyone, welcome back to the webinar. Thanks again for all your questions. We really have a lot of questions today, so it's great to see that people are interested in the topic. We're going to try and get through as many as we can now with the presenters, but if your question has not been asked and you'd really like an answer, please feel free to send me an email, and I'll pass it on to the relevant person who can hopefully give you an answer. Okay, so Tim, we're going to start with you. We had a question from NICOA, who's from the WWF. Perhaps you can summarize his question and give an answer to that, because it's a very interesting question.
I probably will only capture part of it, but I'll see what I can do summarizing. I mean, an important part of this question, an interesting one, is the definition of REDD+. I think, as we all know, REDD+ is reducing emissions from deforestation, degradation, enhancement of carbon stock, sustainable forest management, and conservation of forest. And so those different categories do affect how you account and where you account. And it's going to be the country's decision in many cases in which of those different categories to put a different accounting approach. So we're talking about forest degradation today, but that is writ a little bit broadly in that there's nothing stopping there being forest degradation within conservation and ultimately within sustainable forest management. The different category something gets put in is more, in my mind, how the country wants to arrange the system and how it wants to have its REDD+ strategies organized. And so sustainable forest management could be a process by which a baseline of forest degradation is altered to reduce emissions from degradation and increase sequestration in terms of regrowth of that forest and recovery of the forest. The simplest approach, which is what has been approached and by some countries, and is to just put everything into the three initial categories: deforestation, forest degradation, and enhancement. Everything does really fit into one of those categories, but can be arranged in other ways as well. I think that's what I'll cover on that one, Sarah.
Okay, great. Yeah, thanks for covering that. And remember, if you feel your question hasn't been fully answered, please just send an email and we'll try and clarify things further. Tim, we have a lot of questions for you. We had a question. Let me just find the question. From Giorgio Vacciano. And this is kind of on the definition of degradation. And if the forest grows back after harvests, how are we still calling this degradation? And another person asked us also, what about the carbon that's stored in wood, for example, wood that's turned into furniture or something like that? Is this all covered in your methodology?
Okay, yes. So I think I alluded to this, but definitely worth covering in a little bit more depth. The approaches do typically look at gross emissions. And so, yes, there is possibility in the ideal situation that the forest will grow back completely. The typical experience, I think, of most of us working around the world is that does not happen. After the initial entry of a forest with timber harvest, the forest carbon stock is lowered, and then a re-entry happens after some number of years, 15, 20, 30 years, and a second harvest happens, and the forest is often brought down to a newer, lower carbon stock. The most perfectly managed forest will retain a constant stock through time, and there'll be no additional degradation following the first entry. But you know, we just don't really know, and the literature out there is all over the place on this. It really depends on very much local circumstances. There are cases where, you know, once timber harvest has happened, rapidly follow up with deforestation because you've put in infrastructure that allows the area to be accessed and be used for other purposes. There are also cases where access to the forest and the infrastructure leads to changes in the biophysical properties of the forest so that you get invasive species that come in and prevent the forest ever recovering, or you get increased penetration of winds and flooding or vines and things like this that will prevent the forest recovering. There will be cases where, you know, the forest will recover, and so it's a highly complex situation. Generally, what we can say is an emission has happened at this time. It's happened at one point in time, and recovery may or may not happen over a large number of years subsequently. And then on the topic of the wood products, As I tried to say, this is an accounting approach that looks at the emissions that are specifically from that logging event. So it looks at all the emissions that are anticipated to occur from those logs that are taken out of the forest over a period that would be recognizing the carbon dioxide residence in the atmosphere. So over 100 years, any emissions that would occur will be captured. So that looks at the logs being in use. We'll often look at the decay curve and look at the half-life of those products in use. The IPCC says that most of these products have about a 30-year half-life. And so those then are abandoned, and depending on whether they're abandoned to a landfill or if they're abandoned to be burned or in a debris pile to be decomposed, you know, all of these things are final lines in terms of the specifications of how accounting should happen. A separate approach could be to have a full wood products accounting approach, and some countries have at least considered this, which would allow different mitigation strategies. You'd be able to have strategies where you promote the use of wood products over cement or steel, and increasing the amount of wood products in use in the country would be a mitigation strategy in terms of increased carbon sequestration and carbon storage. But that's a little different from this process, where we really are looking at a piece of forest is being entered at this time. Trees are being cut, trees that were living and had carbon stored in them are being cut. Once that carbon is in a dead form, it is in some degree of a process of going up into the atmosphere, and we try and capture the proportion that goes up in the atmosphere from that log that's been cut from the forest.
Tim, for clarifying that, I think the definition of degradation is always difficult, and you can interpret it in so many ways, so that was a useful clarification. So Lara, I'm going to ask you the question about the wisdom model again. Do you know if there are any, for example, training modules or instructions, manuals, or examples that people can look through of where the wisdom model has been used so that they can follow that example?
Thanks. So what we've done is we've worked directly with the developer of the wisdom model. His name is Rudy Drigo. He's done a lot of our analyses for us. Well, we've worked with him to do analyses. I know that he has offered trainings occasionally in various locations, like 2 to 3 day trainings. I just looked online to see if there were any available upcoming, and I don't think so. But it would definitely be something that I think a lot of people would find useful for some sort of centralized training on this. In terms of, did you want me to answer some questions as well on the data sources that can be used, or?
Yeah, please summarize the question, and then you can answer it. Yeah.
Sure. So, and in terms of what data sources are typically used for the wisdom analysis, they come from a variety. The model, you know, takes a variety of different types of data. A lot of national population statistics. It can also use published and unpublished literature or information from the National Forestry Commission on biomass stocks and on what the mean annual increment are, any kind of spatial data on infrastructure. The nature of the model, as I understand it, is that it is relatively flexible, and it can use all kinds of different, you know, even international data sets if there aren't any available or even proxy data to come up with the best estimate. But yeah, in terms of capacity building, this is definitely, I think, an area that is difficult because it does require a relatively high capacity to get good information out of the wisdom model. So engaging directly with the model developer typically is the best route to go.
Yeah, thanks for that information. Tim, we have some more questions for you. So the questions are now related to the use of the land-based and activity-based approaches. And Basanta Gautam is asking, Are they similar, or how do they differ from the stock change and gain and loss methods in the IPCC kind of terminology? And then another question related to the two approaches from Steffi Hakim is that they used a land-based method and an activity-based method and came up with two different estimates of emissions. Then can you give some advice on how people might choose which method to go for, or how to maybe combine the methods, or perhaps you can just comment on the differences that you will get if you use different approaches?
Okay, let me start with that. I'm not surprised really in that that comes down to the resolution of the change. There's a famous example where you can take two different approaches to calculating the height of a flea that's on top of a racehorse. You can either measure that flea directly, or you can measure the racehorse and the flea together. And you can imagine that the accuracy by which you're measuring the flea's height is much higher if you're just going to measure that flea directly rather than deal with the uncertainty in the height of the racehorse and the uncertainty in the height of the flea. That uncertainty in the height of the racehorse is going to swamp the flea. And so I think something like this is happening in the case of the land-based approach for the logging. What you're doing is you're looking at a massive area, most of which is a carbon stock that's not changing through time, and only a small amount of the total carbon stock is changing through time due to the logging, and therefore your uncertainty in that total area that's not changing is swamping the uncertainty in the little bit that is changing as a result of logging. So I would have more confidence in this case in the activity-based number, particularly as it's lower. If you happen to get a land-based number that was much higher than the activity-based, what you could say is, oh, we're missing something, or we're missing some of that illegal logging, or we're missing some concessions. But because it's the other way around, I would have more confidence in the activity-based. And I think this example reflects some of that problem that happens with the land-based approach. It's good on a broad level to come up with your total stocks and your total stocks through change, but if you want to try and ask some of these specific questions, then it's too blunt an instrument in many of these cases. In terms of Basanta's question, land-based, activity-based is different from stock change and gain loss, though they clearly are overlapping things. You're looking really at gain loss in a land-based approach, but the two things are not fully similar sets, in that you could have a gain loss approach to an activity based accounting, and you can have a stock based change to you can have a stock based change to activity based and a gain loss to activity based, but principally the land base should be based on a stock change, but they're not the same thing.
Great, thanks Tim. I have a question, Tim, for you about this global study that you were mentioning that was published recently. Can you just tell us where the data came from? Is it mainly from FAO statistics, or did you have any other inputs?
What we were trying to do really was take this first approach to have this consistent, transparent, replicable assessment of what degradation emissions are across all of the countries. You clearly could have country-specific numbers and try and pull it all together, but being able to compare between countries then would be really limited. So trying to take an approach where we could be consistent across all of these countries and try and come up with numbers that can be compared and allow us to have that pan-tropical number pushed us towards certain methods. These are not in any way solely based on FAO numbers. For example, the fire numbers come from the analysis of similar data sources, as Lara was talking to, for fire based on the fire products that exist out there. The fuel wood numbers come from largely from the wisdom-based analysis of the non-renewable proportion of fuel wood use. But some of the statistics, and then the emissions from logging come from our own studies, though the statistics on the volume of logs and the volume of fuel wood or the biomass of fuel wood are predominantly, but not exclusively, derived from FAO.
Great, thanks. Tim, another question for you, or maybe Laura can answer. The question is about the soil characteristics and site topography, and whether this is included or could be included in your methodologies, because Claudia Deschamps is saying soils are diverse and can be fragile, and how they respond to being disturbed could play a role in degradation emissions. Is this included at all in your work?
So, I mean, it is an important question. We typically don't include soil in most of these degradation sources. Because it is forest remaining forest, you may get a localized disturbance to the canopy, but unless you get a large area that's cleared for a significant amount of time, then we don't often see a at least sustained drop in the carbon stocks in the soil. You know, if you think of a lot of logging gaps being, you know, the size of the canopy of that tree and not massively more, you're still going to be having a lot of penetration of roots from surrounding vegetation. You're rapidly going to get the invasion of herbaceous and vegetation and young trees into that gap. And so the soil carbon is often maintained. That's not going to be 100% the case, but it is the assumption we make here, and I think it is borne out in the literature. The soil losses typically come where you do get a clearance that's most often associated with deforestation. And then the losses typically will come when that deforestation is to a bare ground use or an agricultural land use. In many cases, if you deforest to a grass-based system, then sometimes those soil carbon stock losses won't happen either. So it is hard to generalize sometimes, in that there are going to be specific cases that make a difference. I think we would expect soil carbon losses on some level, for example, on logging roads where you get 20, 30 meter wide logging roads. But we are unaware of literature on that, and at this point, we don't include it. We really just look at the biomass of the trees.
Thanks, Tim. We've had a couple of questions about fire emissions, and Laura, I think that's something you mentioned in your talk. People are asking about how to distinguish between natural fires and also human-induced fires. And I guess if you're measuring degradation, we've had Letitia Kuamaras and also Karen Simonson asking about this. I guess if you're using remote sensing data, this is very difficult, but do you know of any, perhaps any databases or something you could use to distinguish between those sources, or how might you incorporate this in your analysis when you're looking at fire emissions from fire degradation associated with fire?
Well, what we've seen over the course of our technical support to various countries is that the fires typically do tend to happen around population centers, and so it is, you know, to some degree justifiable to believe that they are, you know, overwhelmingly caused by humans. Of course, there are natural fires, and I think maybe some of what we have seen in our global analysis of what's happening, maybe you know, in Canada, those fires occurring, you know, I guess to some degree would be attributed to natural causes, but by and large, I think, you know, given the lack of data available, you know, that allow us to make that differentiation at the scales that we would need to do it, almost all fires could be considered human caused. But yeah, I think it is a valid point. I mean, it is clearly, you know, when looking at it on a national scale or even at a subnational scale, you know, perhaps additional research could help illuminate, you know, any sort of differences, or help illuminate, you know, maybe differentiate differences between where human fires and natural fires are. But I guess generally it should be said that typically in the tropics, fires are not natural due to the humid conditions. So it sort of really would require a lot of an extreme lightning incident or something in order for it to actually cause the kind of degradation that would actually affect a tropical forest. That's
thanks, Lara. Yeah, it's true that a pragmatic approach has to be taken sometimes. You can't do field work in every location. We have a question on the accuracies of the data in the Winrock report. Yuta Morikawa is mentioning the Winrock report, and I guess that's your paper. How is the accuracy and uncertainty assessed in this, and would the numbers be useful for reporting emissions, for example, for countries?
Clearly, it's always important to have some understanding of uncertainty, and that should be behind anything any of us do, really. Numbers are meaningless unless we have some confidence in them, and confidence in them really does come from an assessment of uncertainty. This really does depend on what data sources are being used, and the capacity and systems within a given country. For example, reported logging statistics in a particular country, are they complete? Are they accurate? That's something that has to be assessed on a case by case basis. Clearly, where there's field work, then you're able to know the sampling uncertainty and the model uncertainty that goes into that, and so we can know the uncertainty and the emission factors in many of these cases. Where remote sensing is used, for example, with the fire emissions, we can know the uncertainty of that system. For something like a wisdom model, the wisdom model tends to not directly consider uncertainty. Hopefully a future iteration would do. So there have to be some conservative assumptions based on that, and it would be based on what's the uncertainty on the supply of the fuel sources, and what's the uncertainty in terms of the demand, and therefore what's the uncertainty in terms of the non-renewable proportion of fuelwood use, and then what's the exactly what's the fuelwood use, and how does that all get integrated together into an uncertainty? So we try to do our best. We are certainly data limited in this case, and it certainly also will reflect the significance of emissions. So work we've done with different countries gets borne out really in terms of the comments we're getting from the UNFCCC or from the World Bank, that if an emission source is 1 or 2%, then having some of these estimates that aren't precisely defined in terms of uncertainty are acceptable. They're just a first estimate of a low emission source. But when you start to have an emission source that's 30% of your total emissions, 40% of your total emissions, then you'd better have a better estimation, or at least a stepwise process in place to come up with a better estimation of how uncertain those numbers are and how to make them better.
Thanks for that answer there. We have a couple of questions about the logging method and the data which is required. And some people are mentioning that in their countries, including Peru or those in the Congo Basin, there are no reliable data sources for logging. So can you perhaps explain how countries should deal with this, what other approaches they should consider if that they can't use that approach? Tim, do you want to answer that one?
Yes, I'll take that. I mean, it is an important consideration, and I think data availability is one of the key factors in terms of any of this calculation. Clearly, it's in the country's interest to try and get a better handle on volumes extracted from the forest. Hopefully that's something that they would hope to do in the long term for management reasons, taxation reasons. There are many reasons why that is a good estimation. But it's reality that those data don't always exist and other approaches are needed, which is why we've tried to develop some of these remote methods to try and get at some of the same data. And so that's the study that we're working on right now under NASA funding, where we're trying to get some of these correlations between LIDAR-based initially estimations of infrastructure and of gaps, correlating that with the emissions that have happened, and then creating secondary correlations with things that don't require someone to go out there and conduct highly expensive LIDAR monitoring. So this is more or less in process and has multiple purposes. It would be there to benefit users who don't have access to data. It also is there to bring in the illegal logging and some of those other data sources that even the best statistics are probably not going to capture. And it also allows some independent oversight of reported numbers on in terms of the statistics of logging, and not relying on unqualified uncertainty in some of the officially reported numbers.
Great. I think we've just got time for one or two more questions. Lara, I have a question for you, and it's about the sources of degradation, because we heard already that there are many different sources, and we talked a lot about fuel wood harvesting, about fire, and what about heavy cattle grazing and how this contributes to emissions from degradation? Do you have any comments on how we can monitor that?
So the stance that we've typically taken is that it's unlikely that heavy cattle grazing causes highly significant degradation emissions. I think the general idea is that where that's been happening, it's in a generally highly managed landscape to begin with, and so any kind of impediment to regeneration might have happened already through time. Tim, I don't know if you have any additional thoughts on this. It's just, yeah, we've just sort of generally not considered it to be significant enough, and haven't come across any convincing information to contrast that opinion. But Tim, I don't know if you have some thoughts.
There are studies that have looked at the area-based impact of grazing alongside these other forms of degradation, and that shows that that grazing is the least important compared to fire or fuel or timber. So in terms of area impact, it's the least important. In terms of carbon impact, at least in my mind, it's even less significant, because what happens is the grazing typically impacts future regeneration. And that will be a long-term degradation. That's going to impact the forest carbon stocks potentially in 30 or 40, 50 years' time, because those trees that would have grown up are not there to do so. But the grazing likely is not really impacting the large trees that are the dominant carbon stock in the forest at this point in time. So the resulting degradation in terms of greenhouse gas emissions in this year of this form, which is, has the lowest area impact, on a proportional basis will have an even lower carbon impact compared to the other forms. So we typically have not considered it to be significant. But it would certainly be possible to design any system. You would be looking at, grazing land adjacent forest areas. Look at the distance of penetration of the livestock into the forest, and then the per unit area damage of those livestock. It would be possible to design those monitoring approaches. But similar to work we've done on mining, you can end up spending a lot of money trying to calculate those emissions, and it comes out that the ultimate emission from the impact of the mining tails, et cetera, on the forest is a fraction of a percentage, and therefore hard to justify significant expenditure.
Great, thank you, Tim and Lara, for answering that question. That's all we have, or just about all we have time for today, so we're not going to take any more questions. Thanks, everyone, for joining the webinar. We hope you found it useful. Don't forget that if you have questions, you can send us an email, and you'll also find the recording of the webinar online by the end of the week. So please look out for that in case you have any things that you want to revisit again. Next week, we'll there'll be a webinar in exactly 1 week from now. That's the 6th of June at the same time, 3 p.m. Central European Summer Time. And that will be on accuracy assessments, so another very useful topic. So we hope that you can join us then. Thanks again for joining the webinar, and hope to see you next week.